I'll be talking about two topics. First is brilliant scattering of light. And if anybody have heard me last year, they have probably heard that. And then I will talk about cooling of magnets, which is a new topic. That's the first time I'm talking about that. Now, all these results will be obtained by Sanchar, who is in the audience, and who is a PhD student in Delft, jointly supervised by Gerrit and myself. So the brilliant scattering story is published last year, and cooling, the cooling story is on archive. Sanchar also has a poster here, and I will omit some technical details, so we would be obviously happy to discuss those details. I mean, we have the whole workshop on cavity spintronics. I don't think I have any extensive introduction into spintronics, and those are things which we need to know if you want to stay with me in my talk. One thing we need to know is that magnets interact with electromagnetic radiation. It's called magneto-optical effects. It's textbook material, established very well experimentally, theoretically, whatever. Now, next thing we need to know is that interaction is enhanced if we put a magnet in a cavity. And that's actually the topic of this workshop. And then we come to cavity optomagnetics. And the coupling is enhanced because we have concentrated electric field and magnetic field in a cavity. Now, cavities could be microwave or could be optical or infrared. Interaction with microwave radiation is resonant because magnets are typically resonant with microwaves, and then it can be very strong. That was the point of the very first experimental paper by Nakamura at the University of Tokyo. Interaction with visible or infrared light is not resonant, so it's dispersive, and because of that, it's weak. And also, that's something which we heard a lot about today. There have been three experimental papers published on the subject during a very short interval of time. So, Sami-san's paper at the University of Tokyo, Hontang's group paper in Yale, and James was just talking before me that this paper from Cambridge. Now, they are all essentially come to the same conclusions. I will show the first one. So they have a waveguide coupled to a Yeag sphere, and the Yeag sphere serves as a whispering gallery mode cavity at the same time, so it supports also photons going around the equator. And they look at inelastic scattering, at inelastic transmission of light, so transmission as a function of frequency. Now, of course, most photons, that's evanescent coupling, so most photons don't even go to the cavity, they just go straight, and that's why we have a huge central peak, which is so big it's not shown here. Now, photons which do go to the cavity, they are transformed into these whispering gallery modes, and they have a chance of interacting with magnets. And because of that, they could absorb or emit magnets, so you have a Stokes and an anti-Stokes peak, and what they have observed in the experiment was that there is a huge asymmetry between Stokes and anti-Stokes. In this case, it's like 10 to the, like a thousand, factor of thousand difference. And which one is bigger depends on the input polarization. So if you have TM, this one is bigger, TE, this one is bigger. Now I will briefly show also the Cambridge experiment just to stress that they were able to achieve so-called triple resonance. So when the magnet exactly fits in the difference between the frequencies of two whispering gallery modes, and under this triple resonant condition, the asymmetry is very strong. Now again, all those experiments were dealing with the Ketel mode, which is a homogeneous magnet mode. And we have just heard James talking about this paper, where they were able to also see higher mode magnets, and in particular excite some magnets which normally you don't excite within homogeneous magnetic field. And also Sami-san's group has a similar paper published. Well, there is some development here, but I will be okay. So I will be sticking to this general setup for my first part. So that's our theoretical setup. We have a waveguide, evanescently coupled to a sphere. We are thinking about Yig, but it could be anything. The magnetization of the sphere is fixed by external magnetic field, and we take it perpendicular to the waveguide. And this is also, the sphere also supports these whispering gallery modes. And we will be looking at transmission and reflection of light as a function of frequency. Now, whispering gallery modes is something we have heard a lot about. They're just solutions of the wave equation on a sphere. They're characterized by three quantum numbers: principal quantum number, orbital quantum number, which is just the angular momentum of a photon, and magnetic quantum number, which is the projection of this angular momentum. Now we are looking at, for the interesting wavelengths, we are looking at modes with very large angular momentum. Their dispersion is approximately linear, and the modes are concentrated close to the equator, so that's why they're whispering gallery modes. There is one detail which is important, that for different polarizations, we have slightly different boundary conditions. We have geometric birefringence, and because of that, dispersion of the modes is slightly different. James had this picture in his talk. I don't have a picture, but we should think about the dispersion like pairs of closely spaced whispering gallery modes with opposite polarization. So there the scale is gigahertz. And those pairs are separated by a free spectral range, which is terahertz. Right, so magnons, again, we need to solve well Landau-Lifshitz equation. We also get three quantum numbers. LS is the angular momentum of a magnon. And there are a lot of magnons in this story, and most are completely irrelevant. There are two types of magnons which are relevant. One is this Kittel mode and the low LS modes. That's what James was talking about, and this is the picture he showed. Kittel mode is homogeneous. This low LS mode are not homogeneous, but they are still occupying the whole volume. And those modes are important for transmission, because for transmission you have a slight shift for light. You have a slight shift of the wave vector, which is translated to a shift of an angular momentum of whispering gallery modes. And then eventually it goes to a magnon, because this shift is associated with the angular momentum of a magnon. And for transmission, we are talking about magnons with these low LS modes. Now, there are also other modes, Damon-Eschbach modes, which are, I was just talking about this process. Damon-Eschbach modes are important for reflection, because for reflection we have modes, light in the waveguide is coming with K, and goes back with minus k, so we have 2k deficit. And this deficit must go to the deficit of the angular momentum of the whispering gallery modes, and eventually it goes to a magnon. So we have magnons with very large LS, and those are Damon-Eschbach modes. And Damon-Eschbach modes are weird in two respects. One thing is that they are surface modes, so they only exist at the surface of the sphere. They don't extend inside. And second, they are chiral. They only go to one direction. All right, so we have to live with that. And that's our interaction. We have seen it already, I think, in all talks in the morning, in slightly different forms. You just write the simplest Hamiltonian you can, so that the energy of electric field, of light, of radiation, magnetic field, and interaction of magnetic field with magnetization, all our interactions are sitting in the dependence of the dielectric tensor on the magnetization. And then you go to textbooks and you see how exactly you should write it. And then, you need to write it, you need to quantize it. So you quantize the cavity field like in quantum optics. You quantize the magnons using the Holstein-Primakov transformation. And then you end up with this Hamiltonian. So these are whispering gallery modes, these are magnons, they're just harmonic oscillators. And this is the interaction, which again we have seen many times today. The interaction contains two operators for photons, so creation annihilation, and it contains either creation or annihilation operator for magnets. So indeed, interaction is just emission or absorption of magnets. And here we have two coupling constants, which don't have to be the same. But these coupling constants are, well, I mean, they in principle exist for all photons and all magnets, but of course they obey the selection rules. And one important selection rule is that you have to switch the polarization. So if you come, if the photon comes with T, it has to scatter off as TM and vice versa. Now you also, on top of that, you also have orbital selection rules, and I will not go into much detail. James was talking a lot about these selection rules for low LS magnets. For Damon-Nashbaugh, actually, the selection rules means that you can either create or annihilate a magnet, because well, I mean, it only can go in one direction. If you provide the angular momentum going in that direction, you can create it or whatever. And if you provide an angular momentum going in opposite direction, you cannot do anything. Right, these are our results for brilliant scattering. That's a cartoon, they're not up to scale. Top row is transmission, bottom row is reflection. We have different input polarizations, and plus minus are input direction, because once you fix the magnetization, then this direction and this direction are not equivalent anymore. And what we see indeed that for transmission we have Stokes and anti-Stokes, and whichever one is bigger depends on both polarization and direction. And for reflection we only have either Stokes or anti-Stokes, and which one is there only depends on the direction but not on the polarization. Now let's understand that. Well, for transmission, that's easy. So that's our expressions for transmission, which are kind of textbook, well, almost textbook. Now, this factor in front is has to do with the losses in the cavity and outside the cavity, so intrinsic losses. And if the cavity is optimally coupled, it's just one. Now, n is the number of magnets. So if you have n and n plus 1 in all the experiments I've shown, this number is very large. So in any case, this n is approximately equal to n plus 1. Now, while those matrix elements for creation and annihilation of magnets are different, as I said, but they're different by maybe factor of 2, and they cannot explain the experimental difference of 1,000. So the difference is coming from the denominator, and let me go to the next slide to explain it. As I said, okay, that's the spectrum is a set of pairs which are separated by spectral range. I mean, that's supposed to be, those two are supposed to be much closer than those two. Now, imagine we are driving one of the modes, like let's say we are driving a T mode. It has to scatter to TM mode. Now, if we if we create a magnet, it has to scatter here. And the magnet frequency can fit here. So that's exactly the triple resonance I mentioned, and that's a resonant process. Now, if you want to annihilate a magnet, we need to go to that mode, and this frequency is very low. This frequency difference is very large. So there is no magnet which is resonant with this frequency difference, so that's not a resonant process. So we have a competition of resonant and non-resonant process, and obviously the resonant wins, and we have a huge difference between Stokes and anti-Stokes. Now, I will not do it, but you can easily, looking at just the same graph, you can easily understand why if it drive TM, then the order swaps. And also, if you have an opposite direction, then those modes are not below those, but above, and again, the order would swap for Stokes and anti-Stokes. For the Damon-Nashbaugh modes, okay, and that I should say, this fully corresponds to what they have been observed in the experiment. Now, for Diamond-Eschbach modes, we have similar expressions, but now the story is different because I said, okay, one of those amplitudes is zero, and so we can only have either Stokes peak or anti-Stokes peak, depending on which one is there. Right. Now, okay, so that's up to now. It was the story you have probably heard from me on several occasions. Now, let's reflect a little bit what we obtained. Well, I mean, we obtained an asymmetry between Stokes and anti-Stokes scattering, so an asymmetry between emission and absorption of a magnon, which means we have an asymmetry between a system getting energy and giving energy to the photons. So we have actually an asymmetry between cooling and heating magnons. And this brilliant light scattering can be actually used to cool magnons, or could also be used to heat magnons if you want. And that's actually correct for both Kittel and Diamond-Eschbach modes. For Diamond-Eschbach, technically speaking, the magnons are already cooled down to zero because only one peak is there. Now, for Kittel, both peaks are there, so that we can ask reasonable questions. Is what is the temperature down to which we can cool magnons, and what is the intensity needed, the laser intensity needed to achieve this temperature. Now, before I go to any equations, let me show this slide. Well, we know that cooling is of course, not, my talk is not the first instance people are talking about cooling. There have been a Nobel Prize given, like in 1898, I think, for laser cooling of cold atoms. But cold atoms are very much different from what we are talking here. For instance, because the number of atoms is conserved and the number of magnets is not conserved. So that I will not spend my time on comparison with the techniques to cool atoms, but let me take some closer example, which is optomechanical cooling. Which Florian is one of the inventors, I guess. And in optomechanics, so you take a mechanical resonator and put it into a cavity. And if you want to cool down this mechanical resonator, this is a cavity, and you drive it not at the cavity resonance, but you drive it at the red sideband. And so you drive it at a frequency, which is the cavity frequency minus the phonon frequency. And then if you do that, you systematically take energy from the phonons and get it transferred to the cavity. And that's how you cool the phonons. And that's something which has been used a lot, because if you want to see, I mean, the frequency of the phonons is at best at high megahertz and low gigahertz range, but typically it's below the thermal energy associated with cryogenic temperature. So if you want to see anything interesting in quantum, then you need to cool those things. Now, okay, what we are doing here is not that. What we are doing here is this. So we have two modes, which corresponds to different polarizations, but it's not really relevant. You drive this mode, and then you cool the most efficiently if you are at this triple resonance, and the magnon fits between those two modes. Now, first we started with a semi-classical theory, that the easiest you can do, basically write the rate equation. We set up a minimal model. So a minimum model has one magnon mode. It has to have three photon modes. You need to have the mode which is incoming. And the magnon has to have a chance to scatter up and scatter down. And for that, you need two other modes. So those three are whispering gallery modes, and this is a magnon. And with these four modes, we have two processes which are competing against each other. So we have either annihilation of a magnon or creation of a magnon. So you couple all those modes to the thermal buses, you take the same temperature, you provide some dissipation associated with the thermal bus, you provide some dissipation associated with the losses outside the cavity, and you have reaction rates, where you need to know this coupling constant. I apologize here, the small g, and on my previous slides on the previous part, there were big g's, but those are exactly the coupling constants which we use for which are in the Hamiltonian. And now you can, okay, you can write the rate equations, you can go to the rotating frame and you can solve them. And you solve them, you find the number of magnets, which is that. And this n thermal is the just the Bose-Einstein distribution of magnets, which is just this function. Now I'm going to analyze this expression in a couple of slides. But before I go to this couple of slides, let me say why I'm not doing it here. Because, well, this is a semi-classical theory, and we had concerns that maybe it's not valid. Maybe we need to do something better. And especially maybe if you go to low temperatures, maybe things happen and the semi-classical treatment would break down. So we had to go and well, provide completely quantum theory. I'm not giving any details here. I would be happy to talk about those details after the talk or during the poster session. So we had, it's based on input-output relations for photons. That's a standard technique in quantum optics based on equations of motion for the creation annihilation operators of for photons. We have, well, equation of motion, Heisenberg equation with dissipation for magnets. We disregard, well, interaction is weak, so we disregard back action of magnets on photons. Then we can solve for photons. Magnets are slow, so we can trade them adiabatically. We can solve for photons, treating them as slow. And then we can substitute photons into the equation for magnets. Well, I mean, there are, you know, pages of formulas behind that, but I will not concentrate on this. That's the equation we get. So this M is not magnetization. Be careful. It's actually the envelope for the annihilation operator for magnet. And we get, so it's written in the rotating frame because it's an envelope. We get here the usual term. So this omega tilde is the shift of the magnet frequency due to these two interaction processes. We have dissipation and we have noise. And noise is the most interesting part. So it's Gaussian. It's zero on average. And the correlation function is proportional to the delta function in time. And the coefficient here is the occupation number for magnets. And that's exactly what we needed to calculate. And the result we get is this. And this K bar is actually those reaction rates, interaction rates times the number of input photons. So the result we get is exactly the same as the result I had on the two slides before from the semi-classical theory. So we had valid concerns about semi-classical theory, but what we get in the end is actually the same. Let's now look at this equation and see what it means. First of all, I said, okay, that's the thermal occupation of the bath of magnets. And you see that in principle, those things are related to rates. So the final number of magnets could be both lower and higher than this thermal occupation. So we could, that describes both cooling and heating magnets. And whether we cool or heat only depends on those dissipation rates and reaction rates. Now we also see that it's not very much surprising. We see that it doesn't have to be positive. So if this condition is not satisfied, then we have instability. So the number becomes, technically speaking, negative, which means that the number of magnets actually grows indefinitely with time. We have a linear, I mean, our magnets are linear, so they're just linear oscillator. We could we didn't do it, but we could have taken into account nonlinear terms, and then we would stabilize this number at some point, which would be determined by those nonlinear terms. That's something which we may do at some point, but we haven't done it. Now, as a function of input power, at lower powers, it's linear. At high powers, this number saturates. And this saturation could serve as the experimental evidence for cooling of magnets. Okay, now let's go to numbers. And numbers are, well, disappointing. So we have taken some numbers without trying to optimize anything first. So we have taken a cavity, 300 terahertz, quality factor of the cavity, optical, so 10 to the 6. Dissipation, magnet dissipation, 1 megahertz, and coupling 10 hertz, which are well reasonable numbers without trying to do anything with them. Then we get this power at which we have saturation, which is 140 watt, which is way too much. Now then we started to think what we can do, I mean, whether it can be optimized. And okay, I'm a theorist, so I don't have any problem saying, okay, we came to the conclusion it can be optimized by 10 to the 5. Now I guess if my experimental colleagues start actually doing real things, it probably comes to be much harder. But for example, one thing is that this power is inversely proportional to this coupling power 2. So you just increase coupling by factor of 10, you get factor of 100 in the saturation power. Good thing is actually you don't need to drive it to the saturation power. You can see experimental evidence of cooling, or you should see experimental evidence of cooling at the power slower. So we check like power, the saturation power divided by 20, you can already see something. And finally, okay, as an example, if we take 1 Kelvin, and we drive them with this power, which is the saturation power, then we get the reduction in the occupation number by factor of 2. So we go from 162 to 0.81, which correspond to 0.6 Kelvin. So that's not a way of cooling the magnets 5 orders of magnitude down to cooling them to microkelvin. That's probably not a mechanism to use that, but it's still a reasonable mechanism to cool them down by whatever factor of 10. It's not unthinkable with the existing technology. Right, here I am done. So I was talking about this brilliant scattering, so that transmission and reflection are determined by different magnet modes. For transmission, we have a symmetry between Stokes and anti-Stokes because of the mode structure of whispering gallery modes. For reflection, we only have one of them because of the chirality of Damian-Eschbach modes. And for cooling, cooling mechanism is coming from this brilliant light scattering. It's different from ultramechanical cooling, and it can be achieved, at least, you know, from a theorist point of view, with the current technology. Thank you.